because kids don't want repetition, repetition, repetition. So we have to find some way to deliver that to them. But 6 years after I stopped playing, I became director of coaching for the SBU. And in the first morning, had the keys, went in, opened up early before anybody else was in. I picked up the phone to a chap. There is, if you're in the bar, I don't know if any of you drink at all. If you're in the bar tonight, there's a wee memorial plaque for him, Tom Hepburn. First morning I picked up the phone and I said, guess where I am, Tom? He said, where are you? I said, I'm behind the desk at the director of coaching at Badminton, Scotland. And he said, oh my God, the lunatics have taken over this. So that was where I started on the coaching front there. And I've had, obviously I've met a lot of people in the sport, but there's one very close friend of mine who also worked with me at the time. And being in charge of a national team, it isn't easy. Loads of pressure. People say, you must have loved your job, loved your job. I could count probably on one hand the number of days that I enjoyed my job. Yes, because every day is different pressure. And anyone that was here last night told one story about dealing with female athletes. And it's very, very difficult and very pressurised. And when you're in, as I went on to be the Institute of Sport High Performance Coach, it brings different pressure, because that is a pressure environment, because you have to deliver. And maybe if I got a wee drink, I'll tell you a really funny story about not getting a bonus 1 year after achieving it. But our sport's changing dramatically. And this close friend of mine that I respect deeply, he said to me, how would you cater for someone like you and your team? Because I'd made all the mistakes. I know all the pitfalls, the dodges, the skives. I'd done them all when I was younger here. But I had done them all, so I knew them. And he said to me, how would you react with somebody like you in the team? And I said, I would try and bring them into a behavioural circle, which as close as you can to what's acceptable to your normal people, and indeed to me, because I was in theory the boss. But I would never expect to get them in the circle. I would expect them to jog back in and out, or constantly around the periphery of the circle. But when somebody is like that, and I said to him, the reason I would put up with somebody that's like that in the team is because they can win. Now, I could win for my country. Didn't they always win? But I could win. I had the chance to win. And that's something I think that we have to look at closely in Scotland today. There's another guy I met many years ago. This is just a quick insight to show you how the game's changed. He said to me, 40 years ago he played, he was at the top of the sport in the world, he played. And he said to me, sitting in a bar, he said, the game's changing all the time. Do you think we would still be as good if it was now our turn? In my day, your sole aim was to make sure your first round opponent had more to drink at the party the night before the tournament started than you did. And he was serious, because that was it. Would Erling Kopp survive in today's world? I think he would. But he would have to change. He'd have to be a different person altogether. The sport's moved on. Everyone at the top is fit. Everyone at the top's fast. Some are faster than others. Everyone's got good shots, some have got better shots than others. It's the tiniest of advantages at the top level, very, very small margins make the difference for them between winning and losing. Now, of course, we have to start at the beginning here with youngsters, and that's why it's so important you're here today. It's a lot tougher for the kids today because of the choices they have to make. Now, that's a very, very important phrase. I chose badminton, not my father.